Do you ground it all and you exponentiate? Your error gets exponential down.
Wait, that makes no sense.
Yeah, the tilde, yeah.
What the hell?
Oh, every day. Let's assume that we're talking about in a non-linear. So how many times did that happen? In 1 year, we're asking how many times, huh?
Wait, this makes no sense. I'm confused. Wait, I'm right. Wait, Mr. Chess, this doesn't make sense.
No, let's see.
That's how much money I would have?
Well, how much did you start with?
Oh, I thought, wait, never mind.
How many started with only a dollar?
I got you, I got you, I got you.
Like, the fact that you have two something dollars is like amazing. Start with a billion, I'll then have like two billion. Pretty good.
Sorry, I was like thinking that.
Okay. 8.0.
Oh, really? Wait, that's. Can I do it?
I love how you went from like having no clue as the expert.
I've been knowing these.
Which one you wanted? Which one you wanted? Let's do one.
The first one.
Okay. We've got the second.
What are the boards?
So you say one? You want to do the third one? Who's got the second one?
Me.
No, we're doing the first one. Go do the first one.
I want to do it. Is the board gonna explode?
It's all, that'd be the board.
When am I divided to the upper board?
I hope it explodes. That'd be really cool.
Your like people, your fans are gonna see.
Hey, got that?
Yeah, so type it all in.
Go back to Greece. No one wants you here.
One over. Be nice, be nice.
Just kidding. It's not a good day.
I'm so sorry. But let's keep talking. Make it a better day.
After me.
Nah.
Yeah, look at that.
What do you think?
That is not what you get. To the 12th. Raise to the 12th.
I don't understand how you can write on this board.
Who's got B? Someone still needs to be. You can come with a new seat. But someone's gotta get B. B and C.
I don't like this much that bad.
No, the problem is right down there. I'm gonna come with you number two.
Yeah, you're right.
There you go.
Oh, just do it on the base side. Yeah, just put your answer over there. There you go.
Every day. Every day.
It's always like half of your April. Why are you doing it now?
Anyway, for B, B is so hard. That's why I don't do it. B is impossible. Go ahead. No, it's just no one volunteered yet.
Yeah.
It's.
That's your one.
I
On the first and the third one, did you get what they got?
Yes.
Alan, can you slap a dollar sign right here? Right here.
Slap a what?
A dollar sign. Yeah, there you go. Talk about money here. We're waiting with bated breath. We just can't stand this. Oh, so it's so exciting. So what, is anything interesting about this? I mean, what do you see? What do you think is happening here? Is there anything interesting that you want to say? What are you surprised by? What do you wonder? What questions do you have about what's happening here? Do you understand what you're doing, by the way?
Oh, I get what you're saying.
So even if a bank was to give you 100% interest, which a bank would, of course, not do, okay? This is like best case scenario here. Best case scenario.
Not really. I mean, like, not with the $1.
Well, yeah, not with the $1, but like, you're getting them $1 and you want, this is like the best bank ever incorporated, okay? And with their $1, you want them to do really well, okay? And they're gonna give you 100% interest. No one's gonna do that for you. But even if they were to do that, compounding monthly, you only get $2.61 total at the end of the year, which is actually pretty good, right? You're doubling, almost tripling your money, right? You start with $1, so that's pretty good. What if you do it every day? What if you do it 5,000 times during the year? Do you notice anything? I mean, what did you anticipate would happen on B and on C? I think at least, my guess is that you would anticipate maybe more money. I mean, you're getting more interest at different times during the year. But remember, you're getting a very, very small amount of interest. Here, 1/5,000th is this number that's going in here, right here, right? So that's a very small amount, very, very often, okay? What do you think would happen if we put instead of 5,000 in, I don't know, a million? Why don't we try it? Do it. What do you think is going to happen? I'm dying to know. Let's do it. What does it be? It'll be 1 plus 1 over a million. With the 6 zeros to the 1 million. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. I think I'm all right. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. What do you think we're going to get when I press enter?
What do you think? Make a conjecture. You already did it, didn't you? You only like making safe guesses. I can see that. Okay, go ahead. What's happening?
It's basically we should actually investigate carefully against the last one. Is it the same? I mean, if you were to look all the way out to 9 decimal places or something like that, they are different, right? They are different, but not very different. It seems like, what's going on? I mean, what is happening here? This is a little interesting to me. What do you think would happen if we put in 10 million or a billion? I don't know. You're actually stumbling upon a very, very important number in mathematics. This is like a little bit of a ceiling for us, right? We're coming up against this number here. 2.718 whatever. Yes? Do you see it? It's appearing out of nowhere. It seems like it's arising out of this very simple operation, 1 plus 1 over whatever, to the whatever, where we let the whatever become very big, right? And it seems like we're getting this number and getting closer to this number all the time. And that number is the subject of today's lesson. Please give it up for the number E! All right, so have you ever heard of the number E? Maybe not. Today is your first introduction, perhaps. But the number E, I think, I would claim, especially as a mathematician, rivals pi for its level of importance to us, okay? And this number E is the one that you just stumbled upon in the warm-up. 2.718281825904. It's a number that is irrational. It goes on forever like pi. And doesn't repeat. So we're going to talk about the number E today.
and only today, we don't really have much to say about it in this course, in calculus or other courses beyond, he shows up everywhere, every day of your life, all the time. So we use this number E, and I don't know if you've noticed in mathematics up to now in your life, but E has been reserved a little bit. Have you ever, I mean, we rarely ever make you solve an equation with E being a variable, an unknown variable, right? It's just like pi. We probably wouldn't use pi to represent something other than 3.141592, right? Likewise, E is special. We reserve the letter E for this number. It's irrational, just like pi is. In fact, it's something called transcendental, in fact, but we don't. A very, very special number. And one definition of E is the one that you came up with today in the warm-up. What happens when you do the following, right? On the calculator we did just now, 1 plus 1 over a million raised all to the million power, to the 1 million power, right? So E is the number you get when you take this expression and keep putting values in for n here that are larger and larger and larger. Right? So that's why I wrote over here on the right. As n approaches infinity, right? In fact, this is such an important definition and such a nice, elegant definition for the number E that it appears painted on our math ball above the lockers over here. And the first 20 digits or so are written here for you on the board. No one will expect you to know those 20 digits. In fact, they're on your calculator too. Just like there's a pi button on your calculator, there's also an E button on your calculator. So there's no need to memorize it, except maybe just for fun, right? Like, that would be cool. Maybe just for fun. Okay, but it's between 2 and 3. You should know that, and you should know that E is not a variable. It is a constant. When we say E, that's just as a matter of convention, that's what we mean. We mean this number. By the way, E is named by, let's see if I get the history right on this. Leonard Euler is this guy's name. He's the most, I'm sorry that you know other mathematicians by name better than you do Euler, because Euler is my favorite mathematician. He's the most prolific mathematician that ever lived. He has the most number of formulas ever attached to his name than any other mathematician. He's responsible for inventing some of our most fundamental notation in mathematics. I being used as the square root of negative 1, Euler. First did that. F of x, we use that all the time. Our function notation, Euler is responsible for giving us that. And there, like I said, I can name at least a dozen formulas that have his name attached to them as well. Swiss guy, Swiss mathematician. All right, so let's play around with the number E in ways that are, in fact, completely expected. Okay, let's keep in mind on at every turn here that E is still that number, 2.718281828, etc. But what is x to the third times x to the fourth? So what is this? This is E to the... E to the seventh, right? Like I said, it's just like as if we were doing x to the third times x to the fourth. Right? With that in mind, continue and simplify the other two, please. It's just about the things we did last unit when we were studying the properties of exponents, right? So, ready, go.
Call on whomever I like for B, at least. C is a little trickier. I'll take a volunteer on C. Mitzi. B, what'd you say? I handpicked you. What is it, 5? 5E, close. What's 10 divided by 5? 2E, right. Yeah, subtract exponents, right?
Yeah.
2E, yeah, good. And then, like I said, I'll take maybe a volunteer for the next one because it's a little trickier, right? Just remember how to resolve our stresses like this. You don't have an idea. Step out on the ledge. See what that would be. Yeah, want to try some? Very good. Let's make sure everyone else knows what you're talking about, though. Okay, yeah, he's right. 3, I remember this squared applies to everything in the parentheses. So 3 squared is 9. I think we're good with that. Yes? Say yes. All right. All right, then what about e to the negative 4x to the 2? Well, what do we do when we have a power of power? What do we do to powers? Multiply. So are you with him? Is it negative 4x times 2? Multiplying powers, isn't that a negative 8x? Okay. Yeah, good. Just for fun, let's also say what this is approximately. Like e to the 7th, for instance. And this would be good because we'll approximate. We'll show you on the calculator here. Well, actually, I want to keep that up there for a second. There is a button on your calculator, and there's actually another e button, but I'll show you this one here. Second ln on your, you don't even know what ln does yet on your calculator, but come down here on your calculator, it's right above the on button over here, hit second and then ln, and it'll give you this e to the button, right? So if you just do e to the first, what should you get? Well, you should get that number e, right? Shouldn't that just be e to the, right, 2.718, and here you can see how close our approximation was, right? To the actual value of e. This is better down here. But we can get arbitrarily close to the actual value by taking larger and larger numbers here. Yes? Cool. All right, the question I just had for you, though, was what is e to the 7th? And I just want to make sure you are clear on this. 1096.63 approximately. 1096.63 approximately. Okay? Just want to make sure it all turns. This is, in fact, up here. Up here, this is what I wanted you to do. Good job. But I just want to make sure at all junctures that you understand that e is still a number, right? There's nothing, right? E to the 7th, that's not like x to the 7th. That's a variable. This is e to the 7th, which has an approximate value of around 1,000. Okay? Just let's not lose sight of that. Questions about that? We're good? Stop me. All right. Okay. No, we should say something about graphing, too, with e involved, like this function right here. So let's do one together. But before you reach for your calculator and type it in all hastily, let's see if we can analyze it from first principles, right? See if we can get, like, kind of a qualitative analysis going first. My first question would be what it says up here. Is this, what do you think, exponential growth or decay? I'd like to know. Does it look like this, you think? Or this? Remember, we talked about those two different graphs, right? Hopefully you did well on the quiz. By the way, I forgot to mention. If anyone didn't take the quiz the day before break, please do that. Sometimes the next ones are out. Okay? You can do it after school today or after school tomorrow or lunch tomorrow. That'd be fine. Anytime is good for me. Okay? Just please come by or else I can give you a 0. That's fine. All right, returning back to the regularly scheduled program. Growth or decay? What do you think? How do you make the determination that it's growth or decay? It's positive, okay. I mean, you might actually come in and do the analysis here. This is e. That's like approximately 3. It's like kind of like this is on the order of like 9 to the x, right? It's going to be 3 squared. So yeah, it's positive. You could say the exponent. I mean, sometimes it's negative. If x is negative, yeah, it is exponential growth. Let's say that right off, okay. Can we name, before you can go to the calculator, can we name the horizontal asymptote? What's that going to be? What do you think? Jocelyn, you can't answer all the questions. Oh, sorry. Desiree, what did you say? Yeah, you're going to answer a question. That's right. Y equals 0 is still the asymptote, right? Even though these numbers are messy, all of the things we talked about before are still in play. Y equals 0 is our asymptote, still. Unless over here you were to add something, right? Like plus a number, and then just like before, even though the numbers are messier, it still works the same way. It moves up and down and all that. Everything you know from before is exactly the same here, except just the numbers are a little messier. What about the y-intercept? What is the y-intercept? Let's say that. Remember, how do you find the y-intercept for any function ever? Plug in. Oh my. How do you find the y-intercept? Friends. Which they just.
Almost when I write
it. Yeah, so what do you get when x is 0 on this guy? If you plug it in, it shouldn't be in your calculator here. What is it? 2 times 0 is 0. E to the 0 is 1. Times 3 is 3. So actually, that's nice. And in fact, this is easy as tricks. That's actually the only one that's nice. If you try this with any other number, you're going to get really messy numbers. But that one was not bad, right? The y-intercept here is 3. Beautiful. All right, we're getting a little bit of a picture here. We think it's growth. We already said we think it's growth. It goes through this point. It's got this asymptote. I'm feeling this now. Are you feeling this? It's going to look like this somehow, right? What's the, before even drawing it, can you name the domain range, maybe? What do you think the domain is going to be? Yeah, just even though it's a little messier, it's the same as every other exponential function. I hope that you got this freebie on the quiz. Every exponential function has domain, all real numbers. What about the range? Again, we haven't fully drawn the picture yet, but it's going to look something like this, I think, right? What do you think? What's the range? What can y be, remember, is what we're asking? What's the lowest? What's the highest? What's it going to be? Again, just like as if we were doing like y equals 3 to the x, right? What'd you do on the quiz? What's the range, John? The range. What's the lowest and the highest y will be? Remember, it's going to look like this. I haven't drawn it yet. Well, remember, it's going to come down here to this asymptote. Yeah, isn't the lowest y will ever be 0? Not including 0, but 0, right? Like I said, I don't think any of this, anything at all that we've just said should be a surprise to you, right? This all should feel very familiar. The numbers are a little messier, so now, finally, if you haven't already done so, let's pull out your calculator. Okay. I would like to graph this on the calculator now. It should just confirm everything we've already said, okay? So if you're entering this on your calculator, you're going to put in 3. This is important. Make sure you know how to put this in. Use that E button, E to the second ln down here at the bottom, right? 2x, that works too. I think that's the same E.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. The thing is, E is so often used as an exponential that in almost every context you'll be using E. You'll be using E to the something. So we just, that's why they have this button readily available for you. Okay, so I already have a pretty nice window set up for it. This thing fires off pretty quickly. I'm actually going to zoom in just a little bit on this thing. I've got negative 3 to 3 on the x-axis. Let's just trace here a little bit. If you trace to 0, x equals 0, y equals 3. Oh, wait, we already said that, right? You got that one. If you trace to 1, already this thing is so huge, 22.2 approximately, right? So actually, I can't even plot that point on this grid on my board. You can do it however you like on your paper, but it's going to be way up here. I'm just going to have to give up on that one, okay? And then over here, what are we going to do? Let's get 1 point if we can over here. Negative 1, if we plug negative 1 in, we get 0.4 approximately. So somewhere down here. Okay, so that's a pretty nice picture. This point here, we don't need to really label it all because I think everyone knows that 0, 3 if we're on a grid line. But this one I might label just because it's not clear to our audience what point that is. Negative 1, 0.406, three decimal places would be good maybe. What that point is, and this point over here is 0, 3. You can label it if you want, I guess. Okay, whatever. We got the asymptote nicely drawn, dashed line, horizontal, labeled with its equation. Domain range specified, everything's beautiful, exactly the same expectations I had when we did this earlier, like nice ones. But always on these, with an E involved, you're gonna have some messy points, and that's just the way it is, sorry. You have a calculator, right? That's part of what we're doing here. You should still be able to graph a really nice, excellent picture. Questions about that process? Right. The only one else, and in fact, I think I'm not going to graph this all the way through. I just like to make one, because really you have the idea now. They're messier, but they work the same way. That's the like overarching principle. But I would like to maybe, this one presents to us a small red herring. Do you see it already? Again, don't go to your calculator yet, but I want you to, yeah, this negative x up top here. What does that do? How does it change the picture? What do you think? It's going to make it decay, yes. Very good. Do you know why? Do you understand why? I mean, if you really were to rewrite this, it would be, if you wanted to convince yourself that this was decay, it's y equals 4 times 1 over e to the x. And 1 over e, that's 1 over 2.718280, etc. So that's a number, 1 over e, that's a number less than 1. So yeah, in fact, I don't really have much more to say about this, but this will be a decay function. Domain range will still be the same as the last one, but it's just going to go downhill instead of uphill. It'll look something like this, right? Okay. Feel free to graph it now if you haven't already. What you will see on your calculator will confirm that. But just for the sake of time, I want to skip over that. We can come back to it if we want. I want to make sure we hit an application or two. All right, this follows on nicely after having done the warm-up today. But we have a new equation for you. Are you ready? It's a pretty exciting moment. A equals P, e to the RT is the equation we're looking at, where as usual, P, E, R, T, and A all do the same things they always have. E, I guess, is the new one, of course, right? But I want to make sure you're clear. E is a constant, right? It's not like from one problem to another, E will take on one value, and then E later on another problem will take on another value. That's not the case at all. E will always be our favorite number, 2.7, etc. But there should be no surprise, besides E, all the other letters that I'm trying to be consistent here are all the same ones we just were using all along here. P is the initial amount. R, even if I didn't tell you what R was, you would say, oh yeah, the rate. T, you know, we name it T for a reason at the time. And A would be the amount you have after T time has transpired. P E V R T PERT free. Remember to say if you want to remember. One thing we should definitely draw your attention to is this small thing going on right here. Right? R is, of course, as always, expressed as a decimal. But if you have growth, then we want to think of R as being positive. And if you have decay of some kind, then we want to think of R as being negative. For reasons that we even just now discussed a little bit.
you an application problem with Duke. And we're going to use this formula. But even before we launch into doing that, do you have any questions about how you think you might use it? Do you understand how things are going to go? How you need to calculate? There are things that need to plug in. By the way, this is the only day we're going to spend on this section. I really don't have much more to say than what we're saying today. But we're doing all of the same things we did before, just now with this new number E as well, in the mix. So tomorrow we're going to move on to some other exciting thing, which I can't yet tell you about, but it's that exciting. Begins with L, though. Are we good? Anyone still need a second to write in the stats? Remember, we are recording, Jeff, so if you need to replay anything we're doing today. PowerPoint's on it. Dealing with continuous compounding. This is what we would do in the warm-up today. Someone could add a part D to the warm-up where they say monthly, daily, and then 5,000 times per year, and then part D, continuously, right? And this is what we would do. This is what we mean by continuously. Compounded instead of monthly, it says right here, it says compounded continuously. Word continuously. Alright, so we're depositing $1 million into this awesome high yield investment account. 7% annual growth. Compounded continuously. That's like the best kind of compounding you can get, right? All the time. Constantly. Continuously. Every second. No, it's worse than that. Every millisecond we're giving you interest. Like an infinitely small amount of interest, but so I'd like to write a model that gives the amount of money you have after t years, right? So how about 11.5 for Gregory? You want to try? What would it be? Just fill in the blanks here. I wrote the formula up there in the corner, over there even. That'd be a nice help. So you just gotta fill in the blanks. P and Will Smith to fill in. Yeah, so, and E, what about E? Don't we have to fill in E? Well, no, E is always the same thing, right? We already said that. It's not like E is different in this problem than it will be in the next problem. So E to the 7t, right? And T, it just said after t years, so we have this model. Does that look good, Greg? Yeah? That looks good, everybody, right? Mm-hmm. Thank you, Carlos. Go ahead. Yeah, that's what I was going to say, Mr. Shapes. 0.07t, right?
Because remember, your rate is always a decimal.
Yeah. I even left space there. Wasn't that good? You like that? Oh, and you're writing in pen. Here, let me use you some more.
I already
did
that.
Yeah, you know, like, and that's why on the play. Okay. And then, of course, what am I asking here in B? What's the balance after 5 years? Do this, then. Plug in 5 Evaluate this function at 5. We got $1,000,000 times e to the 0.07 times 5. You getting what I'm getting? Almost $500,000 more than what we started with. Isn't that great? After 5 years, 7% interest. That's a lot of money, right? I wouldn't mind having $500,000 worth of just interest that I didn't earn at all, just it happens to me, just for letting me borrow money. Okay, letting me. Where did that go? All right, let me get that. Letting me use their bank. Let's see. 1,419.55. All right. Not that we really care about how many cents we have, if we have like $500,000. So yeah, we have about $1.4 million now. That's pretty cool. All right. Comments? That's just kind of the nuts and bolts of how this formula works, right? Let me show you one more example of a kind that you might see, and then I will bless you and knight you, exponential experts. Okay. All right, so take a look at this one. Tell me why this is necessary for us to look at, because it's a little different. What's a different situation? No money. And there is another really important difference in this one.
That's the thing, is to find out why this is an interesting problem. See why? Oh, we lost one.
So I'm looking for a function. It says write the equation for the quantity after time t. So how much do we have to start with, does it say? What's the situation? We've got a radioactive sample. Yeah, 10, we'll write 10. And we'll understand that in general, numbers coming out of this formula are amounts of this radioactive material measured in grams. Okay, everyone good on that? All right, so we start with 10, and by 10 we mean 10 grams. Times, help me out, e to the something. Good. Yes, is everyone catching this? So the negative, it's decaying, it says. Can I bring it more to your attention? There you go. Okay. It's decaying. So, yeah, negative what? Negative what? Yeah, negative 0.063 t, right? And then we're asked also please calculate the quantity remaining after 2 months. Oh, I'm sorry, let's just say this is in months here. This is a little confusing. So after 2 months, plug in 2 and tell me what you get. The part of this problem that's interesting has now been passed over here. Right? But we should say that you should get, when you plug 2 in, you should get something. What do you think? What kind of number are you going to get? Will it be larger or will it be smaller than 10? Should be smaller if this radioactive material is decaying, it's going away, right? Okay, so that comes out to something. Not sure what. 10 e to the negative 0.063 times 2. I think I typed that in right. All right. And is that a little bit smaller than 10? Yeah. 8.8 grams approximately is how much remains. Thank you so much for your attention today. All right. So like I said, this is, tomorrow we're going to move on to another section. This is
your crash course in what EE does for you. And like I said, it doesn't seem that important to you yet. You're like, this is not as important as pi. I can already feel it. You're just wrong, okay? Take more calculus, and then you'll find out. Everywhere we turn in calculus, this guy pops up. EEE. This lesson today brought to you by the number 2 and 3. And the letter E. Take it easy, everybody. I love you all. Practice A, yeah, all of practice A. It's easy stuff, it'll go pretty quick. I promise it's not that hard, even though it might look like it first. Bye.
Smiling.